This program is rated PG. It contains themes and scenes which may not be suitable for very young audiences. Parental guidance is advised.
Be advised that the views and opinions of the hosts and guests do not reflect those of the station.
Hello, my name is Harriet Mwatko. Welcome to our program. In our country, we have a lot of issues that have turned into what we call crisis, be it, well, as of a couple of years back, from the Mama Sapano all the way to the Marawi incident, all the way to the infrastructure that we have to build, even up to our casinos. You name it, we've got it. If not being the pioneer, we're well into it. This is what happens when you have a number of complex issues that need to be addressed all at the same time. But what do we do with that one problem that everyone keeps talking about? One, the roads. EDSA, is that even possible to even address and fix? What about our ports? Gee, not even to mention what we call taxes or the Bureau of Customs, but just our ports. Then, of course, we have our airports, and we're still looking at what are we gonna do? Now, it only takes 5 to 10 years to put that together, but have we even decided what to do? Much, or are we still what the past administration always says, it's under study? But how long do we keep studying? Are we like a professional student that will just keep on going until he's 70 and 80, still trying to achieve a doctorate degree? Are we like this? Is this what it's all about? We will study it, we will study it. It seems government, all the way up, regardless of the agency, to save their ass, always say, we will study it. Then again, that's exactly what you say when you don't know how to address it and you have no plans. Or better yet, you are incompetent for the job to try and bring up solutions. Now, are the heads of government, is this what they're supposed to do? The answer is yes. They're supposed to come up with solutions, which is why they were given or they were appointed in specific departments to solve the problem. Now, you need not be the expert, but you need to be the facilitator if you're going to be head of agency. On that topic, tonight we are going to talk about the railways, the roadways, the railways. Gee, like I said, is there even a way of resolving them, solving them, or is there even a path, a tunnel that will lead us towards some kind of solution? Let's find out. We've got as our guest an old friend of mine. I used to work for him. This is sometime 40, 50 years ago. It just gives you an idea of my age. We were in the bank. He's an investment banker. And many years after that, he got to be an industrial expert on machinery and industry and whatnot. Ladies and gentlemen, I've got Francis Yuseco. The topic, the PHILTRACK Federal Trackway and the Department of Science and Technology Road Train. Hi, Francis. Thank you for being here. Thank Sorry, you. Pinasok yung Philippine Investment Systems Organization.
That was not quite 40, 50 years ago. Maybe 20 years ago.
Not 20 lang ba? I stayed a very short time, but I really enjoyed working there. Yeah. I remember I brought in a big company and I was ecstatic. Shell. I brought them into overnight trading.
Right, right.
And that really blew me up, blew my mind up. That was nice, but I thought I wasn't sure if I wanted to be a banker. Yeah. After being an investment banker, you were into machinery industry.
No, I first started as actually transport and traffic analyst.
Ever since?
That was my first job.
Oh, even before
First Manila Management Corporation. the owner of Pantranco North.
Oh, my gosh.
I got exposed.
The Gonzales. The Gonzales.
No, no, no. Tony Lopa.
Ah, Lopa na. They got it from Gonzales, the old operator.
I think so. But that's how I got exposed to traffic and transport. So I learned the tools of traffic and transport management, especially yung mga relevant laws and tools.
Literally.
You know, to avoid traffic, you know.
Is there a solution?
Yeah, there definitely is. We don't even have to be in this mess that we are. And we can still get out of it. I'm 1,001% sure. If only they would listen to people like us. Okay.
Many a guest that sat in that very chair, and many of them, actually, if I took a measurement of the pro and anti, if there is a solution,
right.
I'd say 85-90% parang wala na ata eh. I'm talking EDSA.
EDSA is solvable. All right.
Okay, how would you solve it? Go on direct to the
if
point.
I'll go back a little to history, all right. When I said I got exposed to traffic and transport, number one thing that you will have to study are the relevant laws, right?
Oh, you have to regulate.
Yeah, you have to regulate. Number one is common carrier's law, okay? Common carrier's law obligates the common carrier, whether it's land, sea,
public
air.
Utility, not necessarily. You're talking about the platform?
Mostly public utilities.
Public utility, yeah. Okay, correct.
Whether it's land, air, or sea, no? You are obligated by law to exercise extraordinary diligence in order to ensure the safety either of your passengers or your cargo.
And both, and yeah, or both.
In other words, when you say extraordinary diligence, that means a lot. In legal parlance. Now, how
secured? That's what it means.
No, that's just one.
Okay.
One aspect.
Secured is just one.
Yeah. One aspect is that ever since before, unfortunately, it's still grappling corruption. That is one of the main factors. What causes trouble? Mm. Okay. Why? Okay. When a lot of the common carriers here. Mm. Especially in sea and land, bring in already condemned,
buses, China, no?
Vessels.
Oh, yung mga luma. Well,
yeah. So when you say condemned, it kick sabihin, condemned na. Hindi na seaworthy,
dapat
hindi na roadworthy.
Basura na dapat.
Right. Mm. Ang problema, ever since before, our LTO, Land Transportation Office, allows they bring in here, and then konting pukpok, konting pintura, konting,
I've seen
those
buses.
Are 30, 40-year-old buses, and they make it appear as 2-3-year-old buses.
Pero it's like our jeepneys, dilapidated. Yeah,
that's why, if you notice, biglang nawawala ng brakes, nasusunog, nahuhulog sa bangil, why? Because no longer roadworthy. Same with our vessels, they're not seaworthy. Katapos magkakaroon pa ng overloading.
Isa pa yun.
That's one. So that's common carrier law. So if you do an honest to goodness DNA analysis of the inventory of the buses, especially cargo, makikita mo naman yung mga cargo trucks. Eh.
Mm. Overload.
Not only the DNA, the age.
Di na pwede, the age.
I mean, these are contempt. Why are you bringing them here? So if you do a DNA analysis, siguro easily 30-40% gone.
Ayun.
So, di ba?
Corruption na naman, going back. Yeah, kasi allowed, binibigyan ng prangkise.
Okay, so one, that's one. Di ba? The second tool is it's a mathematical formula, a scientific formula for awarding franchises. It's what you call a road matrix, road measured capacity.
Okay.
In other words, given a certain corridor, where it's... EDSA, for example, you measure the length, the width, no?
Kung anong ilang kaya lang.
Ilang kaya lang. There's a mathematical, scientific...
May formula.
Foolproof formula. Kukombine mo yan sa tinatawag what they call origin matrix analysis, no? Ilang ba talaga ang kailangan na public utility vehicles dito?
So, pag-aaralan mo rin yung demand, ilang sumasakay
that's what you call origin origin destination. Okay. Pag-aaralan mo yan.
Pag-aaralan.
And then you combine it with the road measured capacity. All right?
Okay.
So, after that, I became an investment banker. But there's a relation. I'll tell you why later.
Capital.
No, the foreign loans.
Okay.
Okay, I'll tell you. Okay. And we got exposed to this, remember, Harry? Okay, tinan mo. So, ang problema, in the granting of the franchises, hindi sunusundan eh. Yung formula, scientific eh. It's because of graft and corruption again. Mm. No? Kung lalapit sa ano, I'm sorry to say, no?
Go ahead, we have to be frank
about this. Hindi nasusundan yung formula kung ano, lalakarin yung franchisa. Ayun. Kahit sobra-sobra lang, pumuputok na yung
Bibigyan pa rin.
So root cause, graft and corruption. Mm. Root cause of the other LDO, graft and corruption. This one, graft and corruption.
Correct.
All right. Now, so I left
Dumable
that.
Na yan, oh. Dumable na.
I became an investment banker.
Okay.
That's how we met. Mm. I was a working student. I was supporting myself in UP. Okay. So, investment banking is good. If you remember, the PISO and PDCP were the only conduits for World Bank, IMF, JICA, ODA.
Okay, yung gusto nila, di ba?
Okay. In various multilateral, bilateral export credit facilities. Hmm. On paper kasi, they look concessional, soft. Hmm. Less than 1% interest, 7 to 10 years moratorium on principal. 30 to 40 years on
for
maturity.
Infra, basically for infrastructure, building up a nation, country.
Yeah, but even at that, Harry, if you remember, no, we were very selective in choosing the only export-oriented dollar-earning company. Why? Because pag pinautang ka ng mga yan, whether it's JICA, IMF, they dictate the currency that they will lend to you.
Okay, yeah.
So these are basket of currencies, US dollar, Japanese yen, Dutch guilder, German francs.
At the time, yes.
Diba? Okay. After that, it became euro. Okay. So, okay. But we wanted, you know, we were young, naive at that time. No? Sabi naman, you know, mura to. Why not?
Of course.
Diba? So, but then we were careful. I was talking to Vic Barrios. We still have to, you remember Vic Barrios.
Of course.
We have to be careful because after 40 years, we don't know the value of the peso vis-a-vis this basket of currencies.
Pagdating ng payback, no?
Exactly. So, when we were originally lending, the exchange rate was what, about 7-8 pesos to 1?
At that time.
Porque under the IMF tayo, after 5 years, sabi ng IMF, mahina currency mo eh, kasi you're import dependent. They value your currency. So yung 8 peso to 1, naging 14 to 1. So the effective interest rate is not 1%. It's not less than 100. Naging 50, 100%.
Double. Correct. Okay. Siyempre.
After another 5 years, it becomes 24 to 1. After, now it's 50 to 1.
Correct.
So, when the original loan was financially close, you only need 7 pesos and 80 centavos to pay the same dollar of loan.
Not anymore.
Diba? But you still have your operating administrative expenses. So you need maybe 15-60 to pay the same $1 of loan.
Siyempre.
Now, you need
50.
100 pesos
sobra,
to pay the same. So, after that, if you remember, you know, we loaned to three, you know, giant textile companies, all export oriented. One shipping company, one agri export company, food production, mining company. What could have been one of the biggest telco company?
Oh my gosh! Okay.
So after that, after it became 14 to 1, none of them were able to pay.
Siyempre.
Hindi ba? None. So they all closed shop. And these were the captains of the industries during the time.
This is what happens when a country has to devalue. But there are other economic benefits, supposedly. But nevertheless, in this particular case,
they use this, what they call economic rate of return. that's a magic word. I mean, you can say that. What's important? Will I be able to pay the loan? So when the first LRT1 was financially closed in Brussels, Belgium, the exchange rate was 780 to 1. So sabi ko, if dollar-earning captains of industry, export-oriented, some of which were even publicly listed, cannot pay this JICA, ODA, IMF loan, what more a major infrastructure project that's only earning in pesos? And you have to be price sensitive because this is being used by the general public.
Correct.
Hindi ba? So sabi ko, wow. Well, nothing is gonna happen. So I went back ngayon to my skills or to what I learned.
So traffic.
Traffic and transport. And then I started analyzing, you know, because there's a mindset when you talk about mass transit. Necessarily it has to be rail-based. Eh? That's the mindset. Diba? But because of our experience of sa piso, no matter how much you say, concession or
hindi mo mababayaran
yan. Hindi ba? Impossible. So sabi ko, I analyze, I use the AIM case method study based on Harvard case method study. Medyo nag-aral din naman tayo niyan, di ba? So sabi ko, inanalyze ko, so what makes a rail-based system operationally efficient? It's not because it's running on rails, but because it's truck-based. Meaning may sariling truck or daanan.
Tracks. Yeah, track.
Diba? T-R-A-C-K. Diba? Once you have your own exclusive track, it's what you call a completely controlled, therefore completely programmable environment.
Oh, siyempre.
Sariling daan mo yan.
Forward, backward.
You have the absolute freedom to program all your operating activities. Your headways, your dwell time, your average speed, your top speed, you know, the design and the distances, your loading, unloading station, the ticketing system, centralized.
Lahat.
Sa'yo yan eh. The LRT is operationally efficient, not because it's running on rails, but because it's up there.
Already.
Binigyan mo na sariling daan yan eh.
Correct.
Baba mo yan. Kahit correct. Ilang tinuladang relays yan, ilang kilometering relays yan, mata traffic din yan. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
So, rails are nothing more but carriageway of steel wheels para makaikot yung gulong na bakal. Roads are the carriageway of rubber tires, pneumatic tires. But both of them would take 360 degrees.
But ang rails designated specific. You can't have any other transport on top of the rail other than the train. Hindi naman pwedeng lalagyan mo ng truck sa tracks.
No. Kaya nga they were, you know, remember, Harry, there are three words in railroad truck. The rail and the truck. But the operative word is the truck.
The track.
So once you have your own exclusive truck,
Okay ka na.
There is no law, no church that tells us, well, you have to use steel wheels. And you have to use rail trucks.
Okay. Well, we're going to have to take a short break, Francis. Stay with us. We are getting there. The reason why there is an explanation is to ensure to be definite, a real comprehension to what we're trying to reach at. Francis will open that up. If you stay tuned, as soon as we come back, he will bring it out to you. The solution that he says, there's more than 1,001 ways to resolve that problem. Gee, if only we could do that now, right now. We'll be right back. Stay with us.